last 10 years, six good-looking New Yorkers have rocked our world. Ross, Rachel, Chandler, Monica, Phoebe, and Joey are now everybody's best friends. But how well do we really know them? Tonight, we reveal the geeky past of these glamorous stars, the ones before the nose jobs. We speak to the people who knew them intimately.
When she arrived in New York, she was a virgin. I fixed that.
And show you some of the roles they'd rather we forgot. But all that bumping and grinding coming up later. From its debut on September the 22nd, 1994, Friends became one of the most successful TV series ever.
Friends!
And its six stars are now some of the most famous faces on the planet.
Jennifer!
Seen on our screens every week for 6 months of the year, the stars of Friends soon developed an emotional bond with their viewers.
I realized I was starting to like my friends on TV better than I like my friends in real life.
Friday night, you've had a hard day at work.
You could just sit down and have half an hour of escapism.
It allowed the singletons of this world to kind of enjoy the Friends as family, if you like. No one told you life was
gonna be this way. The key to the show's success was the unique appeal of the six previously unknown cast members. Almost overnight, they were propelled to levels of fame and fortune that were unprecedented in the history of television.
Everyone knew all of the six friends' names. There were merchandise everywhere, T-shirts.
When you walked into a restaurant with them, heads turned, kids ran for autographs, you know, little girls cried. It felt more like a mania.
But no one knew this was going to happen back in the spring of 1994, when producers Kevin Bright, Marta Kaufman, and David Crane held auditions for the show and these friends first met. Back then, our future stars were just a bunch of young unknowns, scraping together a living working on TV movies and failed sitcoms.
I think when all of the actors came to Friends, there wasn't a great deal of experience behind them.
There was just enough familiarity, but not enough to breed contempt. We just wanted to know more about these people.
When the six actors arrived for the casting of a pilot originally called Insomnia Cafe, only one of them was guaranteed a role.
They did write it with David Schwimmer in mind. They had seen him for another show and still heard the rhythms of his voice. And that's very hard to recreate.
David Schwimmer was lucky, but then he had always nosed ahead, even in his childhood in Hollywood. It was 1984 at the Beverly Hills High School when the 18-year-old teenager got his first sniff of fame.
Well, I knew David as a very bright kid, but he wasn't somebody I worked with a lot until we worked on Anything Goes. And I remember thinking he was too bright to be an actor. Fortunately, he didn't pay any attention to my thoughts. But he had tremendous comic timing, but he also had that kind of serious approach to comedy. If I try it this way, it'll be funny. If I try it this way, it'll be more funny. And it was like working with a colleague.
Early. You might get him running a temperature.
These Englishmen have high boiling points.
Yeah, that's true, too. Then let's frame it. Can't you wear something that slips off easy? And then I'll bust in and accuse him of tearing your clothes off.
David was so bright that you'd make a suggestion to him about his singing, and the next rehearsal, it would be better.
When your instincts tell you that it's faster, faster and faster.
There's a little piece of videotape when we were loading the sets after Anything Goes where you see David basically screwing around and everybody giving him a hard time for it.
David Schwimmer doing what he does best to contribute to the strike.
So, thanks a lot for your help, David.
People knew they could joke with him because he could take it.
At the same time, one of David's future co-stars was also excelling in school drama lessons, and she too seemed to have a nose for comedy. Brought up in a Greek family who had changed their name from Anastasikis, Jennifer Aniston was born for telly, quite literally. Legendary lollipop cop Telly Savalas was her godfather. Acting was in her blood, and in 1984, 15-year-old Jennifer won her chance for fame at New York's legendary School of Performing Arts.
I would have to say that early on, it was clear that Jennifer was more or less already ready for prime time.
Like most young actors in America, Jennifer started on the sitcom circuit with a series of disastrous flops. The first, in 1990, was called Malloy, in which she starred alongside Maureen Bialik, the future star of TV show Blossom.
I had never really worked in television. I didn't really know what I was doing. And she came from an acting family, and she was just very sweet, she was very encouraging, and she made it a lot of fun, and I knew everybody thought she was funny, and she was also stunning, I mean, still is.
Sadly, Malloy was cancelled after only a few shows, but Jennifer went straight on to another sitcom, the TV spin-off of Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Let's set some ground rules here. I am a senior, you are a nothing.
Got it.
Good. When we're at school, pretend we are not related.
Okay.
Good. Keep a low profile.
The lowest.
Fine.
Ta-ta.
Unfortunately for her, this show was also a disaster.
You can't manufacture a miracle.
They'll last maybe 6 episodes, 13 episodes. I think the most I did was 19 episodes of a show. And then they're never heard of. Nobody knows about them.
As a young girl, Jennifer's future co-star, Courtney Cox, was just as determined to hit the big time and was using family connections to get there. She'd grown up dreaming of fame and fortune in the steel mining town of Birmingham, Alabama.
Well, Courtney Cox's trip to the top actually began with my father making a trip to Birmingham, Alabama, his hometown, to visit his brother, my Uncle Hunter. And my Uncle Hunter had just married Courtney's mother. And he said to Courtney, so, young lady, what do you want to do when you finish college? And she said, I want to be a model. And he said, oh, well then you should go see my sons. My three sons virtually own the entertainment business. He was prone to exaggerate, my old man.
Apart from managing his little brother's band, The Police, Ian also ran a music talent agency in New York.
I kind of took her under my wing and gave her a job at my agency so that she wouldn't have to go out and waitress and so on and so on. And at the time, I didn't really have an acting division. But eventually, I formed one, really, to handle Courtney, who I soon thereafter fell in love with.
Courtney and Ian's relationship was far from conventional, even for the Deep South.
I was considerably older than her, nearly twice her age, and she was my cousin. In fact, when she arrived in New York, she was a virgin. I fixed that.
Cut!
But Courtney got her own back by acting just like the character we'd later see on Friends.
She got me to quit drinking. She rearranged my wardrobe. She would definitely have a propensity to pick guys who needed help.
Ian helped Courtney's early taste for fame by arranging various modeling jobs for the ambitious teenager.
She was the kind of model who advertised Tampax rather than the kind of model who would be on the front cover of Vogue.
Well, in fact, Courtney Cox was the first person ever to use the word period on national television.
Does your life change once a month because of your period? Still using pads?
Originally, Courtney didn't want to do the ads, and I had to talk her into it mainly because the money would pay the rent.
Tampax tampons protect internally, so you feel cleaner. No pad can do that. Feeling cleaner is more comfortable. Plus, more women use Tampax than any other tampon or pad. Now that's something. Remember, there's a feeling with Tampax. It can actually change the way you feel about your period.
In 1987, Courtney left period dramas behind when she landed a role in the smash hit comedy Family Ties, playing Michael J. Fox's girlfriend.
Nice jacket, Mallory.
Oh. Hi, Lauren.
Hi, Lauren. Where are you guys off to? Little touch football game at McKinley Field, bunch of us play every Saturday. Just a friendly game.
Whoa, yeah, it was a friendly game until I was invited to play. Whoa!
Sorry, just a reflex.
She was Michael J. Fox's squeeze, so naturally she was the object of affection for a lot of American boys.
I have been lucky, yes, but I think I've prepared for it, so I don't know.
Matthew Perry, on the other hand, was preparing for something entirely different. Age 13, he was living in Canada and was one of the country's leading junior tennis stars.
I wanted to be a professional tennis player, but then I wasn't good enough. Isn't that a sad story? So now I'm an actor.
But it was hardly surprising that the smell of showbiz lured him. Matthew's dad was famous as the original Old Spice guy in this 1970s advert.
Old Spice is the clean, fresh, masculine scent so many women love. So even if you love only one woman, you'll love Old Spice, the man's scent so many women love. Y'all don't wanna
hear me, you just wanna dance. With all those ladies around, it was no wonder 15-year-old Matthew left Canada to join his old man in Hollywood, enrolling at LA's prestigious Buckley High School.
I think the moment that he got to Los Angeles, it was a dream that opened in front of him. You could see that Matthew was going to draw people to him simply because he was fun to be with.
I auditioned for a school play, for a high school play called, Our Town, the famous play. Yeah. And I got the part of George Gibbs in Our Town, and I had such a great time, and I realized it was the only thing in school that I really liked working hard at.
Matthew's early success on the stage at Buckley soon got him noticed by big-time casting agents.
His first television series was and is literally one of the worst television shows in American television history. But suddenly he'd established himself as someone that could go places.
Hi.
Good afternoon, Miss Pembroke. I'm Mr. Pembroke. Nice to meet you. I'm Ed Staling.
Charles in Charge was one of those shows that the critics hated. It revolved around younger people, so you see a lot of young, fresh faces of actors that have gone on to, you know, much more prominent things.
My father's a Princeton man and a neurosurgeon. I'd like to follow in his footsteps.
Welcome to the family.
Like Jennifer Aniston, Courtney Cox, and David Schwimmer, Matthew Perry had finally managed to get himself onto the circuit of sitcoms and pilots, a notoriously cruel world for any young actor.
The experience of trying to get yourself on a hit sitcom is sort of like being a sperm trying to fertilize an egg. And your odds are, I think, very similar.
After the break, more from our friend's embarrassing back catalogue, including Matt LeBlanc's saucy introduction into the world of TV. And we'll see that for Jennifer Aniston, there's just no running away from a terrible movie.
Get in the ring. No holds barred.
We now have a winner.
The ultimate playoff. All day long, Friends versus Big Brother.
Oh, my.
Friends, the final eight shows.
Uh-huh. Are you kidding?
And the very best bits of Big Brother.
No!
I wonder what my best moments have been.
Friends versus Big Brother, Friday from 2 on E4.
This is huge.
I know.
By the end of the 1980s, most of the future stars of Friends had already appeared on America's TV screens. But there are other ways to break into Hollywood. Simply having the good looks is sometimes enough, especially for a 17-year-old Matt LeBlanc at Carpentry College in Boston.
I went to a technical vocational high school, which where you learned a trade. My trade was carpentry.
He'd always come in with a smile and, "How you doing?" I wouldn't say he was Joey, but he had a good start on Joey at that time. But he must have got the acting bug and must have known he had talent, and away he went.
Realizing his passions lay elsewhere, Matt gave up a promising career as a carpenter when he left Boston for the bright lights of New York City.
I had just gotten fed up with doing construction and, you know, working outside in the cold, framing houses, and someone had said I should go to New York to get into modeling, so I said, okay, anything to not have to bang nails in the snow.
He came to my class with his friend, and he was barely 18. He had just come from Massachusetts, and he looked like an incandescent Christmas angel. This is what he looked like. And after he'd been here a little while and started to go out on serious auditions, mostly for commercials at that point, this is what he looked like. Now, isn't that gorgeous?
Matt's smoldering good looks won him a series of parts in commercials, including this saucy role in an award-winning ad for Heinz Ketchup.
Thank you.
hot dog, please.
One more donut.
No, thanks. I got it covered.
Heinz tomato ketchup. The best things come to those who wait.
And with that, he bought his first home in California and his first motorcycle and a whole, and I think a car as well, and a whole collection of clothes with that one commercial.
Lisa Kudrow's background had nothing to do with acting. The daughter of the world's leading expert on headaches, she was herself a brilliant academic, graduating from New York's prestigious Vassar College.
I was really just happy to focus on studying and getting good grades and going to an Eastern college. That was my big goal.
You know, I don't know exactly what got Lisa into acting. I know that she was working on a degree in neuropsychopharmacology, I believe, which is what she was gonna go into. So how she made the leap from that to this, I don't think I even ever asked her. I think I was scared of the answer.
Saturday Night Live star John Lovitz, a family friend of the Kudrows, spotted Lisa's potential and suggested she audition for the famous improv group, The Groundlings.
The first time I saw Lisa was in her student performance that she did here, and she did a monologue as a character called Hilary Mandel, which was hilarious and quickly became the buzz all around the theater. You know, this new girl came out of nowhere, and I had done my student performance the month before, and I had been the buzz prior to that. Yeah.
Lisa took to comedy instantly, and her obvious talent meant Hollywood soon noticed her.
People were just falling in love with that dry delivery, that subtle approach, that ability to play someone on a different wavelength.
By the start of the 1990s, all the future cast were beginning to get noticed. But some, like poor Jennifer Aniston, for all the wrong reasons.
She has this bizarre cult following in America because she was in a movie called Leprechaun.
It's about an evil, twisted leprechaun who wreaks havoc on Jennifer Aniston, who's wearing hot pants and has massive hair. A leprechaun!
It's about a leprechaun, played by myself, who is very evil, but he's misunderstood. People steal his gold, and he goes after it, and if anyone gets in the way, they are killed. I would like to hope Jennifer is secretly proud of it. Publicly, I've heard she isn't, and she really doesn't like to be approached about it or have it mentioned in any way, so my apologies. You know, she should be proud of it. I mean, it has achieved cult status.
But Jennifer wasn't the only one dwarfed by the land of make-believe. Courtney Cox was also trying to keep a straight face while using telekinetic powers in the very forgettable Misfits of Science.
Danger, danger. High voltage. When we touch. When we kiss.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And talking of fantasies, Matt LeBlanc showed us the size of his talent in this soft porn epic.
Matt has done his fair share of kind of rubbish on TV. I mean, he's done sort of soft porn films, The Red Shoe Diaries.
Well, I'm sorry, but I mean, I apologize to all the people involved, but I don't think those movies were particularly good movies.
Sex bomb, sex bomb, yeah. You're a sex bomb.
But while some of the friends were still sweating it to get parts in Z-list movies, Matthew Perry had opportunities fall into his lap.
I was in a restaurant on Ventura Boulevard in the Valley in California with a couple of people. I was skipping school.
This kid walked by, and I never forget, he had this kind of youthful, square-jawed kind of innocence. It was like a young, Jimmy Stewart or something. And I remembered the name of the waitress. Her name was Astrid. I said, hey, Astrid. And I said, come here. I said, you see that kid over there? She said, yeah. I said, he's a movie star. She said, what's his name? I said, I don't know. I'm going to give him a part in my movie. She said, you're kidding. I said, no. She said, wow, I wish that would happen to me. I said, it's about to happen to him.
I got a note on a napkin from a director who said, I'm doing this movie in 2 months in Chicago, and I'd really like to have you be in the movie. And I was like, okay. A little skeptical. I figured, this movie's going to be shot in the back of this guy's van.
In the ultimate Hollywood fairy tale, Bill gave 17-year-old Matthew a part in his film, starring opposite River Phoenix.
I just thought he was a star. And you can tell people, you know, sometimes when you see them. That's why they call them stars, really. When you lay eyes on them for the first time, there's something about them. And Matt had that quality. He was only 17, but he was a miniature Matthew Perry, and he was wonderful as Fred Roberts.
Right. I'm desperate.
You've got another venereal disease.
No, something else. Can we talk inside?
You're going through another abortion.
No, when I got home tonight, my old man told me he found out about it.
I told you something like this would happen.
The film was a critical success, and it opened Matthew's eyes to the world of cinema.
Matt used to come and visit, and River Phoenix came, and Keanu came up on his motorcycle, and one time he came over, and Matt was there, and I said, I gotta tell you, man, just don't do television. Just stay away from series TV, and I remember him looking at it, and I said, you know, I know you gotta work, though, but so if you gotta work, but try to just stay in the feature end of it, because you never know about television, man. It can just eat you up, right? So that, he didn't take that advice.
David Schwimmer, meanwhile, had ignored cinema to concentrate on theater work in Chicago and some select roles in TV dramas.
The traditional Arnold nuclear family unit, plus the man who came to dinner.
David Schwimmer came on initially as my boyfriend, as a reoccurring role.
The Wonder Years. Wonder where the nose went.
Why don't we take a walk and talk this over?
There's nothing to talk about.
What does that mean?
Michael.
Karen, all I did was ask you to marry me.
Whoops.
You very much reminded me of just the sort of sweetest, cutest puppy dog. Very open and very charismatic.
But fame was still just out of reach for all the cast, until Courtney Cox reached out and grabbed it from the boss.
I think people, when they think of Courtney Cox's first big role or breakout role, it's always going to be that Bruce Springsteen video. I go to bed feeling the same
way. I ain't nothing but tired. She got pulled up on stage for, you know, 26 seconds of film dancing with the boss, and her career was launched from that point. Hey, baby.
But we knew she was special from the moment she did that. Anyone would have pulled her out of the audience. She was exquisite.
By early 1993, success was tantalizingly close, especially for Lisa Kudrow.
It's an interesting story about Lisa Kudrow. Before she landed Friends, she actually was cast on Frasier in the role of Roz, which is Frasier's producer on the radio show.
She actually did get the part and was fired. And that happens a lot. You know, they get you on the set and the chemistry isn't right or whatever. That's happened to me a couple times.
She says, you know what, they told me I just wasn't a right fit for the part. And, you know, I was probably had a better role waiting for me out there. And boy, was she right.
Could she have been more right? When Friends producers Bright, Kaufman and Crane auditioned the six cast members, they instantly knew they'd hit on something special. And our six new friends realized they'd finally found the show that would propel them to fame and fortune. The rest is history. Next time, we reveal just what happened to them as they became global superstars.
And that next time is actually only 3 minutes away, so you can toddle off and make a cover and then come back to join our friends on the A-list.